AP 120, Chapter 11, Topic Steroid and Nonsteroid Hormones. So, we are moving on to the endocrine system, and the thing that links all these very distinct and separate structures is the production of hormones. So, cells, tissues, and organs that secrete hormones can fall in the endocrine system. So glands, as I'm sure you remember from Unit 1, glands are made up specifically of epithelial cells that make and secrete something. Something. There are the exocrine glands that have ducts and secrete substances that go on a surface, such as saliva into the oral cavity or sweat onto the skin. And then there's endocrine glands. Endocrine glands do not have a duct. Instead, they secrete their substances, their hormones, into the surrounding interstitial fluid or directly into the bloodstream. So again, endocrine glands secrete their hormones into the bloodstream or into the surrounding tissues. Now, the endocrine system and the nervous system are similar in that they both involve communication. They're sending out signals to help maintain homeostasis, to do things for the body, to the body, in order to maintain a stable internal environment. Now, the nervous system does this using neurons, and it is an extremely fast process. And at the very ends of the neurons, at the axons, they'll release neurotransmitters, chemicals that will then make the postsynaptic structures respond. With the endocrine system, the glands secrete the hormones into the bloodstream, and then they travel throughout the body, and they only affect target cells. And a target cell is a cell that has a receptor that can bind that specific hormone. So even though basically most of the cells of the body are exposed to this hormone, only the target cells with the receptors will respond. And this is a slower process, and usually it's a long-term one. So the signal, the hormone, is secreted for a rather significant amount of time. All right, so again, key thing, no receptors, no response. You need the correct key to activate the change in the body. An example of this in the real world is androgen insensitivity. The way this works is an XY embryo develops, so what we would expect to be a male embryo. However, this individual is missing the receptors for testosterone. So what happens is that the person develops as a female. And basically, the only way they find out that they are not XX female is that during puberty, they never begin to menstruate because they lack a functional uterus. All right, hormone secretion is regulated primarily by a negative feedback loop. And that means, hopefully you said B, it means a decreased change away from normal. So as something gets too far from normal, negative feedback will cause it to return to normal. All right, hormones. Hormones can be steroids. Steroid hormones are lipid-based, so they are hydrophobic lipids based on actually the structure of cholesterol. And then the other kinds of hormones are basically derived at some level from amino acids or proteins. So the other kinds of hormones can be amines, parts of an amino acid, peptides, a couple amino acids, proteins or glycoproteins, glyco with carbohydrates. And hormones do not need to be in high concentration. They can be at a really tiny amount in the bloodstream and still get the job done. So steroid hormones, again, synthesized from cholesterol, so they are a multi-ringed carbon structure. They are able to pass through the cell membrane because they are hydrophobic. They are able to cross the membrane with ease. And then they're, however, they don't have the ability to travel in the bloodstream easily, so they are carried by specialized plasma proteins. So the steroid hormones are carried throughout the bloodstream, attached to special plasma proteins. And then when they get to the target cells, they can actually cross the cell membrane on their own relatively easily. And steroid hormones include estrogen, testosterone, aldosterone, cortisol. Those are a few. So the receptor that the hormone is looking for, in this case, is actually in the nucleus. So not only does the steroid hormone cross the cell membrane, it also crosses the nuclear envelope and goes into the nucleus. And when the hormone binds to the receptor, that complex is able to turn on a specific gene. So the hormone binding to its receptor will cause a gene to be activated, and that gene will transcribe or code for what? Protein, lipid, carbohydrate, or messenger RNA? Correct answer is protein. Genes lead to the production of proteins. You do have that messenger RNA intermediate, but the important final product is a protein. So here is the steroid hormone released by the plasma proteins. It crosses the cell membrane and then it enters the nucleus where it can find its receptor. So it's looking in the nucleus for a protein receptor that it can bind to. It then activates the transcription of a specific gene, and then that messenger RNA will leave the nucleus, find a ribosome, and lead to the production of this new protein, which will change how that cell functions. All right, so the other kinds of hormones are non-steroid hormones. They have to bind to receptors on the cell membrane because they cannot cross the cell membrane on their own. And when they bind to the receptor, it leads to an activity inside of the cell. So some examples. Norepinephrine and epinephrine, that is also known as, my mind just went blank, not testosterone, adrenaline. Norepinephrine and epinephrine are forms of adrenaline, thyroid hormone, parathyroid hormone, luteinizing hormone. There's a bunch in this category. And again, they are binding on the surface to cause something to happen inside the cell. This is signal transduction. The signal is being sent across the membrane. Hormone on one side, effect on the other. So here's that non-steroid hormone, able to travel in the bloodstream all by itself. It doesn't need any help. Gets to the cell's membrane, and then it binds to its target receptor. Binds to its membrane-bound transmembrane target receptor. And then this causes things to happen on the other side. So for instance, activation of C-AMP. We're not going to really worry too much about the specifics here. Just know that after it binds to the receptor, chemical changes occur within the cell that lead to activation of proteins. So there are proteins that are already present in the cytoplasm of the cell, but these proteins are inactive. They're not doing anything. But the binding of the hormone to the receptor leads to a cascade of events that then activate that protein, causing things to happen. And that is it for this part of the lecture.